Hi, my name is Bert. This is my first time here on a Sunday, so hopefully you aren't confused at why I'm here. But I thought it'd be nice if at least I told you a little bit about myself so you have some context. This is me last week. This is me as a child. I was saying that this is probably actual size. I've only grown a little bit since then, but this is where, back in the States, and this is in Illinois, where I was there for about 4 or 5 years. And you can see I was very Chinese even back then. I was wearing glasses at 4 years old. I like to blame that for why I'm short. It stunted my growth. There's heavy lenses. We then moved to California, and I loved playing basketball. Sadly, I was only 4 basketballs tall. I think now I'm about 6 basketballs tall, so slightly taller, but still, I was saying I'm the tallest person in my family. I'm taller than my parents, I tower over them, and thankfully my son is taller than me. He was very worried that he was going to be shorter than me, but he is a towering Chinese 5'7", which is just so much taller than me. I grew up in California, which is why I sound like this. This is not just a side effect of a lot of television or too much friends. So I grew up in Southern California in Los Angeles. In the city that I'm from is actually called Monterey Park, and it's full of Chinese people. It's like Chinese people everywhere. And I went to UCLA and I studied English literature, which means that my English is very good, but my Chinese is very poor. In that way, I'm quite a disappointment to my parents. I think they always hoped I would learn better Chinese, but sadly, that never came to pass. I will say in the past few years, my Chinese has improved because I actually work at a Chinese-speaking church. My parents are from Taiwan originally, so they grew up to me speaking in a Chinese dialect called Taiwanese, which has no written form, and it's like a street language. So it sounds completely different to Mandarin, sounds completely different to Cantonese, and so they taught me that growing up. I also discovered that the bulk of that language is insults to children, so that's the extent of the Taiwanese that I know. But what's interesting is, how did I become a Christian? Well, our house was right behind a church, and my mom was a Christian already, so she wanted us to go, but my dad was not a Christian. And my mom became a Christian because her parents were Christians in Taiwan, and they had come to know Jesus, and my mom then came to know Jesus, and so she wanted her kids to come to know Jesus. But where did my grandparents hear about Jesus? Well, it would have been from some missionaries who had come to Taiwan previously, people who were probably sent from Chinese churches in the States to come over here, to go to Taiwan. And there's this whole journey of coming to know Jesus that I don't think we think about enough. Like, especially if you grow up and you've come to church or you've been here for many years and your kids have come to know Jesus, but actually everyone has a story. And I think that's one of the most beautiful things that we get to share together, that we all have a different story and we all have a different journey of coming to know who Jesus was, to coming to believe him, to come to know and accept him. And those stories are so beautiful because that helps us see that we're all very similar, that there's not that much difference between us. Even though there's a lot of beautiful things about our cultures that make us different, the fact that we're all saved by God's grace is something that is so beautiful. That wherever we come together and we can worship together, it is so precious. So I've been in the UK now for about 27 years, and so this is a picture of our church. It's a converted warehouse. This is our baptism service, and so that's one of our sisters, she's getting baptized. There's a pool that opens up on the bottom of the floor there. I think that used to be where the people would service the cars, so there's a big hole there. Our church is cold, which is why everyone wears their coats inside. On a Sunday, we have 5 services, and so we are 3 languages, but mono-ethnic. We look pretty much the same. We like similar foods. But actually, across the services, we have 3 different languages. We have Cantonese, so there's a lot of people coming from Hong Kong, maybe some people from one part of China. Then we have our English-speaking congregation, which is a lot of people who grew up here or were born here but have a Chinese heritage background, and they found that this is a fantastic place for them to grow in confidence, to express some values which are different from different parts of this country, and so they have a chance to be able to grow and understand God's word in that beautiful place. And people from, a lot of them from mainland China and from Taiwan, Mandarin. Now, what is really cool about this is, even though we all kind of look the same, and sometimes I have a hard time telling us apart, they're actually quite different. So even on a political spectrum, it's quite different. So you have people from mainland China whose current ruler has placed a lot of pressure on people coming from Hong Kong. And then you have people who grew up in the West who have a completely different understanding of love and discipline to their parents. And yet in our church, it's somehow we are bound together by God's love, where you can have even people on the different sides of the political spectrum say, that's not the most important thing, but that we're saved by God's grace is precious and wonderful. And it's something that's not able to exist everywhere, but it's something that we know is very precious. In our church, there are people that come from all over the place, like I said before, from some Koreans, from Taiwan, from Singapore, from Malaysia, and also from all over the UK. And so when they end up in Birmingham, they end up finding a home and a space in our church. And one thing that's really precious about it is every church has a chance to express the culture that God has given them, to understand God's word and express it in a beautiful way. And every culture gets to see the power and beauty of God in a slightly different way. In other words, no culture has a monopoly on God. And the more you get to see different cultures have the freedom to express the beauty of God, both in their own cultural understanding and even in their own language, the more we get to share that. It's kind of like the wealth of delicious restaurants we now have in Birmingham. You get to try really good, authentic food from another place. And as you grow to appreciate it, and maybe you don't like it, that's okay too. But to have that wealth means you can take something with similar ingredients and create something just as beautiful, reflecting. And for us, it's a chance to reflect the beauty of God in different ways. And this kind of leads us on to the message that I want to have today. And so that first part was a little bit for this morning for the kids, but give you some context of our Chinese church. But today I want to talk about Philippians chapter 4, 1 to 9. And Philippians is this letter by Paul that he's written to the church in Philippi. But of course, these letters were passed around and shared among different churches. And it's the end of the book, or end of the letter. And he's kind of writing these encouragements at the end. But one thing that I want you guys to start off thinking about is, a lot of times when we read the Bible, we read it very personally. Like, oh, what is God saying to me? What is the Lord saying to me? How am I understanding this? But we forget, these are letters that were read out loud to the people, to a group. And there's a sense back in that time where there's a collective kind of understanding, a collective congregational receiving of this word that I think sometimes we miss. Especially in the West, we have this strong individualistic understanding. Like, I want the word to speak to me. I want the service to speak to me, which is wonderful and precious. But there's also something so powerful about letting God's word speak to us. Right? And it's like looking at the people next to you, like, oh, this is speaking to us. We're here together to hear God's word, to let God's word impact us so that we can reflect God's love outwardly. I mean, the hardest part about that is that we have to be connected to the people next to us. One thing great about today, at least this evening, with like I guess 100 people not here, is you have luxury seating, don't you, right? This is not like EasyJet or Ryanair. You've got lots of space. You don't have to sit next to people. In our service right now in our church, our building's too small, so it's very much like a Chinese restaurant. Some people will come in and they'll say, three people. Someone at the door will shout across the hall, Samwai, which means three seats. We're looking for three seats, and then they'll come and seat them at those three seats. So everyone has to sit next to each other. Not super COVID, I mean, COVID friendly if you want to get COVID, but very, very cozy. And I think that's disconcerting to us sometimes, right? Because we want our own personal space. And the danger is sometimes we want just our personal spiritual space. We want our reflection of Christ to be the only thing that matters. And the hard part about people is that If you don't like them, they're annoying. They're bothersome. They're smelly. They think different things. I'd much rather just go back into my car and drive away. But God calls us to come together. And I think this last chapter in Philippians gives us ideas on how we can do that better and how we can understand how to do that. And so starting off, I forgot there's a whole section here about this. So I took this analogy of musical notes, instruments. And I think for all of us, we're kind of this note, aren't we? Like, and sometimes we're, in America, this is called a whole note. We just hang out and we stay there for a space. Sometimes in life, we're moving a little bit faster. And sometimes we move even faster. The little flag at the end talks about how fast it's going. And we find ourselves rushing through life. There are times in life where things are going up. It's like, da, la, 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 la. Life is great. And other times, life is, it's sad and draining. And there are times in our life where things are feeling flat, where things are feeling on edge, and sometimes things are feeling back to normal. But what's really cool is when the notes get to hang out with each other. Okay, so one note by itself played over and over again, yes, there's a famous jazz piece that is that. It is interesting. But when notes get to hang out with each other, they create sounds that they cannot make by themselves. You have to take two notes living in different lines. When you hear them together, there's this harmony. And you add another one, it could be another thing. And another one, it's a richness that you miss when you're just on your own. And when you begin to see how beautiful it is to be with other notes, you can start to appreciate them, even if they're a bit flat. Maybe it's just because they're in a different key signature. Maybe if they're going too fast, maybe it's because they're playing at a slightly different rhythm. I think the hard part with us in society or with our families or with church is that the notes are everywhere. Everyone is on a different page at a different time, and it feels just chaotic, like a mess. And sometimes we'd wish that a conductor would come and pull it all together, but then if we don't like that conductor, or we don't like that way that guy's doing it, say, well, I don't want to listen to that person. I'd rather do it my way. I think when Paul writes this letter, he's trying to say, hey, actually, I want you guys to learn what it looks like to live together. And what it looks like to be a composition of Christ. Understand that all of us who are different and unique and might have a different pace or a different tone, actually, if we're letting God compose us together, he's creating something beautiful. So we'll look at this passage. Let me read this, this whole passage out. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, you whom I love and long for, my joy and my crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, dear friends. I plead with Euodia and I plead with Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you, my true companion, help these women, since they have contended at my side in the cause of the gospel, along with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always, and I say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all, the Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. Therefore, and so let me break this down, right? When we think of Paul, a lot of times we think of him as, you know, he's so sharp. He's got a sharp mind. He's got that legal background. He's always speaking into the churches, like, shape up. You shouldn't do things like this. But if you look more carefully, actually, at how he starts his letters, a lot of times how he ends them, he is very pastoral. He has so much love for the people. And it's not just that. He has such deep connection with them. Right? What does he say? My brothers and my sisters, who I love and long for. Like, he's not just telling them off. He's not just saying, do the right thing. He's saying, I love you, and I long to be with you. When we've written letters to people, we don't, you know, like, we're okay with, like, oh, yes, it'd be great if you do this. We don't say, I miss you, or I long to be with you. And here Paul is saying, my heart wants to be connected with you. You are my joy and my crown. And then he goes on and he names them, right? And he's saying, look, actually these two women, Euodia and Syntyche, he's pleading with them. to change something about something that they're doing wrong, something that's not going right. And he's asking his friends, Clement, and he's saying, these are people that I've served with. They're people who are close to me, who have contended for the faith with me. In other words, he has a genuine connection with them. He has a long-lasting, real connection with these people in this church. And that's the starting point of how important this is. What is your connection like with people here? I think one of the biggest challenges sometimes is you might have been here for a long time, but things change over the years, and it's hard to know who you're connected to. You may be here for the first time, and you're like, I don't know where to begin to make the connections. And it can be so overwhelming trying to figure out. But if you break it down a bit smaller and saying, actually, God, I want to begin to make connections with the people around me. And you think, actually, I want to be able to make spiritual connections with the people around me so that I know how to pray for them or what they could use prayer for or how I might speak blessing into their life. Like when we have that spiritual heart, we're thinking the same as like Paul, you know, you're thinking about the spiritual well-being of the people around you. He knows what to speak into their life because he has that genuine connection with them. Church is absolutely precious. Like, the older I get, the more, you know, after you have kids, actually, once I got married, all my single friends did not call me to hang out anymore. And I asked my wife, do married people just not have friends? Like, where do you meet friends, right? And the older you get, you have kids, you hang out with the primary school parents for a bit, and then your kids get too old, then you don't bother with the secondary school parents, right? And then next thing you know, like, where do I make connections? Where do I make friends? How do I connect with people? But church, you know church is amazing, actually. Every week you get out, you get to see different people. You can bring people who are lonely into this space, and if your church is healthy, you know someone will welcome them. Not just the person who's supposed to welcome them, but other people. And that is so precious. When I think a lot of the Hong Kong immigrants who have moved here, a lot of them are coming to churches not because they were Christians in Hong Kong, but because they moved here, they're lonely, and they don't know where's a safe place to go. But they have a feeling church is okay. They may have met one or two Christians before, and they're like, at least I can go to church. And that connection can begin to make such a big difference. I think for us, when we look at what Paul's writing, and he starts out writing, he's confronting an issue with these women, but he has the right to do that because he has a genuine connection with them. If I came to you guys now and said, you know, you guys are all sinners and you're all going to hell. Actually, I'm assuming you're sinners, okay? I don't really know what your specific sins are, okay? Because I have no genuine connection with you. I'm not gonna lie. I'm not gonna pretend like I'm your friend, because I'm not. I don't know you. I don't have a living relationship with you. So for me to tell you off, I have no basis to do that. I think that's how we are a lot of times, right? We see something we don't like, we leave a Yelp review, or we complain about someone online, but we have no genuine connection with these people. So those comments don't matter. The idea that Paul is telling the Philippians is you are this body. You are this reflection of Christ. And the genuine connection I have with you, you also have with one another. And so as I speak truth into your life, I know you will receive it because you know that I love you. And you know I'm seeing this for the good of God's glory and that love there. It's hard because it forces us out of our, I think, our comfort, our safe space, to say, actually, I want to become a person of blessing to someone else in this church. I want to deliberately be able to pray for someone in this church so that if something comes up, I know that I can pray alongside them and contend with the faith with them. And that is something beautiful that we miss sometimes in Paul's life, his deep relationship with the people there, this genuine connection that brings it to life. And so I think from here on out, he gives these real tips on how to actually connect with one another. How do you actually let God compose you? And he starts off with this: rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. That's been turned into songs, you might know it, but if you just read it straight up, it's really interesting because he says, rejoice in the Lord always. I'm going to say it again, rejoice. Right? Like he's really emphasizing rejoice. Why? Because actually, I don't think rejoicing is our natural non-spiritual state. I think our default state is complaining. The sun is out. Oh, it's so hot. It's raining. It's so wet. When will summer come? Like, it's our natural disposition of complaining. And it might not be malicious complaining, but there's this criticalness in our heart, the cynicism that kind of is always bubbling underneath. And Paul's challenging that, saying, look, as a believer, as you, this community, one of the things that has to be stand out above you is this rejoicing, but not in just anything, rejoicing in the Lord. It's that reframing that's important. When you as a believer can stop and you think about what God has done, like his goodness, his mercy, his grace, you know, actually just providing for you in small ways, just the peace that you get, just the fact that you are not necessarily anxious about what happens to you when you die, like that is such a blessing from God. And it's this idea then, God, let my heart rejoice instead of being cynical and bitter or being pessimistic. Rejoicing in the Lord keeps your song from becoming cynical and pessimistic. Like this world, right, it seems like it's getting more cynical, more pessimistic, and the news cycle is so draining. And and those things are true. There are bad things happening. And it's not about being Christian, being blind to these things, but as a Christian, our picture is, how do we see the Lord's faithfulness and goodness, and how do we rejoice in that, even in the hard times, even the difficult situations? There's a video a few years ago of Egyptian Coptic Christians who were about to be beheaded, and you might have seen this online, but it was quite a scene because they had captured all these Egyptian Christians, and they had them all lined up, and it was a public execution of them. And after they were executed, they actually, the news people went to the families of them in Egypt, and they went to them and they asked them, you know, when you saw this, how did this make you feel? What would you want to do? Do you want to take revenge against them? And the family said, my brother was there, and I praise God because I could hear him say, Jesus is Lord. And they were so happy because they're like, because I know my brother did not turn away from faith. So I rejoice in God, and I'm glad because he could testify even at his death. I'm like, whoa, okay, this is a completely different way of thinking than I normally take. Then the news person then asked him, what would you do if that person who killed your brother was here right now? And she said, I would invite them into our house and share a meal with them because they don't know the truth. They do these things because they don't know the truth. If they know who Jesus is, they would think differently. And I thought, this is truly loving your enemies. This is truly rejoicing in the power of God, even in the darkest times. And then I compare it to the things I complain about, like I'm moaning about super first world problems, like the traffic or the sunshine. And I think to myself, man, my worldview is so messed up that I let these things cloud me from the amazing power and goodness of our Lord Jesus Christ. And if I could tap in every day to think, Jesus, what can I rejoice in you about today? What is the good that I see you doing? What is the power that I know that you can do? Your life completely shifts. If you think about the people you enjoy hanging around with, the person who is the most miserable or downcast or pessimistic, they drain you, isn't it? And sometimes we're that person because life is hard. But the person who can turn the darkness into hope, into rejoicing, into life, into reframing the perspective, isn't that what God is challenging us to slowly become? Not that we're there already, but in the hardships that we face, we continue to see the goodness of God throughout that journey. The older I get, I like to think I'm old. Today I went to McDonald's and they're like, it's 50th birthday for McDonald's, which I assume is in the UK. And I turned 50 this year and I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm the same age as McDonald's. It's a sobering moment for me. Then I thought of all the calories I'm eating, and I thought my blood pressure, but sobering, very sobering moment. But there's this journey where I think about, as I've gotten older, I think about what is most valuable in life, you know? Can God continue to shape my character, my being, to be more like him so that I am becoming more of a composition for his glory? And there's this beautiful idea that actually you are never too old or too young to start being tuned to him, to let your song, your sound, be more reflective of what he desires in your life. And I think that starting point of rejoicing is so key. That beginning point of actually really just resting in all the goodness that God has done. Let's move on before my meeting starts and I'm in big trouble. The second thing is let your gentleness be evident to all because the Lord is near. Gentleness from the Lord's presence keeps your song from being selfish or bitter. And gentleness is this interesting thing because I think in a society, gentleness is something we're not so keen about. I mean, there's a whole thing, toxic masculinity takes off because it's the opposite of gentleness. And yet, as a believer, God is saying, let your gentleness be evident to all. Like, that should be the standout feature of this Philippian church, gentleness. But what kind of gentleness? Like, what does it mean? It doesn't just mean being a pushover, but the love and the compassion of God being so clear in your life. That's what people see. And I love the reason he says this, right? Let your gentleness be evident to all. Why? Because the Lord is near. The more you're aware of the Lord's presence, the more gentle you're going to become. Because you can be, like, you can shout, like, so that whenever my wife and I have a fight and it escalates and afterwards, you feel really guilty because suddenly, like, oh, wait. I don't think Jesus liked that. You know, like, I don't think Jesus was that keen on my short temper or my impatience. So this past week, my wife had a big argument because I lost the co-op shopping bag and I took it to church and I forgot where it was. And we had this huge, seems really ridiculous, but this is basically marriage. So huge the fight was way too loud for what it is. And then I said to her, okay, I'm sorry. Look, I'm sorry because I wish I could be more patient. I wish I was more patient. And I realize I lose my identity in Christ when I get angry. And I forget that the Lord is near. And I said, but what I can do, honey, is get better, learn better, recognize the Lord's presence sooner. Because I know actually that has been the whole journey of my marriage so far. I have continually let God keep teaching me and shaping me, not so that I can be a better husband, that's a side effect, but so that I can be more and more like Christ. And I think the more we recognize the Lord's presence near us, it will change the way you look at people. Like, you can be so judgmental to someone until you realize, oh, hey, Jesus, yeah, you were not that judgmental to me. Actually, you forgive me and you give me mercy, so how can I withhold mercy to someone else? God, you are gracious and gentle to me, so why am I so mean to this person? God, you should judge me for how bad I am. And here I am casting judgment on my Uber driver. Like, we're totally in the wrong, right? We have to stop and say, actually, God, let my life just become more like yours, full of your gentleness, full of your presence. And then it goes to this passage, which we're probably so keen about because it's one of those passages that gives us hope. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Praying, trust God with a composition. So the whole idea is when you're anxious about it, when you're worried about a lot of things, when you're all sorts of things that you're stressed about, as you pray them and you submit them to God, the reason it guards your heart, you know, as the reason it transcends all understanding is because it puts all those things into perspective. When you start saying, actually, God, you are Lord over all of this, Like, what do I have to be stressed about? You've been faithful before in the past. God, I can trust you in every circumstance. And that's the hardest part, isn't it? Really remembering how faithful God has been. But when you stop and you think, actually, I probably shouldn't even be a Christian. You know, why should I be saved? How did I end up loving you, Jesus, that you would save me so much that it doesn't even seem fair? Okay, God, I can trust you. And also because you have already overcome the biggest obstacle in my life. You've atoned for my sins. You've paid. That's something I can never do by my own power. Because you've already atoned for my sins, man, I can trust you with everything else small, everything else that's going on. In my life, what I'm learning to do is each day, the things I'm anxious about and I fail, the stresses overwhelm me. At the end of the day, I look back and say, okay, God, I really overreacted. I really overreacted over this. God, I submit to you. I trust you. Tomorrow, let me not be that way. Let me trust in your faithfulness and your goodness. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. There's a couple things in here, right? It's what your mind is focusing on. It's almost coming back to the first couple things, like rejoicing or like don't be anxious, right? Because you're focusing your thoughts on the goodness of God, on the goodness that he's doing. Even in the darkest moments that you're seeing the goodness of God and what he can do. Then the second thing is seeing Paul's example. And this is another sign of his genuine connection. He's not just saying, look at me like a rock star. Anything you've seen or heard or seen reflected in my life, you've seen that I'm not a hypocrite, you've seen my compassion, you've seen my love, do the same thing. And the other thing is then to practice, right? Learn, see what is good, what is true, what is right. Practice those things. Every day you have a chance to practice. Know where your spiritual inspiration comes from. See from your leaders, see from the Bible, the truth of God, and let those things reflect. When we think about musical compositions, one of the biggest things about it is learning to practice. And practicing is the worst, especially as like scales are so annoying. So as a Chinese person, we are all forced to learn a musical instrument growing up, normally piano, sometimes violin, sometimes cello if you're larger. Myself, I was forced to learn piano, and then I quit, and I dropped out, and it was really bad because I hated practicing. I learned flute, I also quit because I'm a quitter. And I remember my flute teacher was really, I don't know how she knew, but I could play really well by ear. So I can like hear something, I can play it. So she'd play something and I'd play the same thing. And she'd say, you're not reading the music. I'm like, how do you know? How do you know I'm pretending like I'm looking? But she could tell I wasn't practicing. I was faking it, but I wasn't practicing. I think for our spiritual lives, similar, isn't it? Not that we're fake Christians, but the goodness in our life is veneer. It doesn't always run that deep. You know how you know is every time a test comes up, when you lose your temper, when you're suddenly more impatient, when you're faced with that thing that makes you really jealous. Those are all really important because that lets you know where you need to practice. You shouldn't look at those situations like you failed and you're a bad Christian. You should look at that situation as, oh man, I still got to practice this. God, thank you for the opportunity. But keep letting me be shaped and keep training me so that I can be the best sound that you want me to be. But this message, again, is not just for us personally. It's for us corporately. How can we be a sound that is beautiful? How can we show God's love through our interactions with each other, through the graciousness that we show with each other, through the patience and the love that we have, which means we interact with the people who are not our favorite people, because that will also help us to grow, help us to be shaped, and help us to learn. On to his one last story. So, yes, I'm a pastor. I will say I'm not a very good one. But there was this guy in our church who was super annoying, like super duper super annoying, really drove me crazy, really bothered me. And one day he was sent me a really annoying text message. I was so angry. I was like, oh, I'm just going to erase it and like ignore it. But I thought I'd tell my friend, this guy is really annoying and he's really bothering, except I replied that guy with that message. I know. And this was before you could delete messages. It was just there. And then I was like, oh my goodness. It was such a convicting moment, right? Because it's the pretend you're a good Christian until you get caught out with a bad thing. And I remember I had to go to him. I had to say like, oh man, I'm sorry. And what was crazy was I knew God was trying to say, you should spend time with this guy. You should listen to him. You should minister to him. And I was like, well, this guy is the most annoying person in the world. But after I sent that message, I was like, okay, God, you're right. He's not the most annoying person. I'm the most annoying person. I act like I'm good, but then I'd say stuff like this behind someone's back, and that's horrible. And so then after that, I spent lots of time with him. So much time with him that we became good friends. So much time with him that he comes back and says, actually, it was the time you spent with me that really changed my perspective on things, helped bring healing in parts of his life. And it's not because of my goodness, it's because of God's amazing grace. And it's funny because sometimes when we think about God's composition and we think about the sounds that people make, we're just like, it's too discordant. But what you're actually asking God to do is tune us. Tune us so that we're the right sound. Bring us into the right part of the song or the melody, where maybe they're a bit flat now, but later on, the whole key signature shifts and we all match. Maybe we have different parts of our harmony, but there's something beautiful that God is composing in us. It's this beautiful idea to let God compose you, becoming more gentle, becoming more rejoicing, becoming more thankful, praying more, but also composing us, encouraging one another to those things, and praying for one another. Shall we pray now? Lord Jesus, we thank you so much because you are incredible. You are so gracious to us, so merciful to us, and sometimes we walk around this earth like we are the kings and queens of it. We are entitled to certain things. But Jesus, you are our Savior, you are our Lord, you're the one that we look to, and you're the one that we want to hold on to dearly. Will you shape us? Will you mold us? Will you tune us? Will you compose us into what you desire, Lord? Let our hearts be humble and open to being shaped by you, that every challenge that we face, every time that we fall short, we see that as an opportunity to learn and to grow and to become more and more like you, so that the sound of our life is resonating you in every single way, that there's a beauty that comes reflecting off of us that is just pushing and demonstrating your glory, because this world is so broken and so lost and so discordant that it needs your people, your church, the same way that you needed and inspired the Philippian church to be like you. Lord, inspire and lead and guide us, Lord. We are your people. You write your song in us. We thank you in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.